Beneath the skin of the city, Durban pulses with memories. Each street has its legends. Every building holds a secret. But come with me on a journey to find the real mothers of Durban, those Indians of the 1950s whose stories still reverberate today. Back in the 50s, a section of Durban's Indian community lived here in the inner city. This whole neighborhood around Grey Street is now known as the Casbah. Listen to these lines by Durban's own novelist, Aziz Hassim. The Casbah is another world, another country. When you know your way around, an army of cops wouldn't find you. You could disappear for weeks. We're about to meet Aziz. He's coming for the ride. He'll guide us through the Casbah.
Hey, Yasin.
Okay.
This is Daddy. He's been here 50 years.
Wow.
We're now a very old customer.
His father was my grandfather was a barber.
My grandfather was a hairdresser. My uncles were hairdressers. So I'm the last link at the moment. Started the hairdressing from the age of 18. And haircut was 25 cents that time. Children's haircut was 15 cents.
And Aziz, how long have you been coming here to address our
Ever case? Since I was 7 or 8 years old. That's what, 70 years ago. To play soccer down here in the arcade because after 5 the shops used to close.
You ever gave any cuts to gangsters?
Yeah, there used to come. Footballers, Crimson League players, M.M. Freddy, one of my favorite customers.
I see you were Aces United.
I was a Bria supporter. Bria supporter. But we supported all our Indian teams.
Hey, come with me, I want to take you on a little tour. Thank you very much. Cheers.
The Indian has often been represented as passive, but these streets saw some pretty tough guys.
We're meeting Farooq Khan.
Top journalist of the old days.
Exactly.
From the drum.
The doors opened at this place on the 6th of June, 1944. That's 65 years. And it has had a checkered history. And I am sure that the owners will tell you, Aziz, you'll agree with this, that it has never had a dull moment. This was basically the vicious heart of Durban's gangland.
This is where the Crimson League, you know, had its beginnings. They started off as a vigilante group, but later on it became a gang of extortion and all that kind of thing.
There was the Big Five. There was Big Daddy Naidoo, there was Akhi Vayed, there was Pine Muhammad, there was Chotu Bana, and there was Mad Mullah. And they were regarded to be the kingpins. Any other people who wanted to deal in any kind of criminal activity had to go through them.
Well, the Crimson League gangsters were there. The sellouts were there. Sellouts were the guys which ran the taxis.
Now, sellouts hailed from the Overport area. And they had a section of Grey Street to themselves, and Crimson League had a section to themselves as well. Salutes and Crimson League never saw eye to eye.
Right across the road, there were taxis.
Well, that was a sellout corner.
That's it, they had the 3 taxis out there and the 3 here. Those 6 taxi ranks was the bone of contention between the Crimson League, who was run by the Big Five, and the Salutes. The Crimson League wanted those 6 taxi ranks.
They tried to muscle the sellouts out, not realizing sellouts would fight back.
That was the beginning of the war. A number of attempts were made on the lives of various members of the Salot. And one of the first warning shots were fired from this very place against Dees. The bullet missed him. It was in the evening, he was sitting on the boot of the car. The Crimson League wasn't happy on that. They then decided that they wanted to murder Lighty. Lighty had gone with his wife to a dressmaker to have a dress made. And somebody informed the Crimson League that this was happening. So they waited the time. And when they saw Lighty going to pick up the dress, they brought in Michael John. Michael John was a name to be feared. He was probably one of the most brightest young minds of that particular time. It was he who led the attack on Lighty. They broke into the house, they hit him with iron rods. And when he was senseless, they held him up, and Michael John took an axe and he chopped his head. That's how Lighty died.
The old man, he was a fiery guy who took no nonsense. He told his sons, go out there and fight for your rights.
That led to full-scale war.
But the Casbah wasn't all about gangsters. At the heart of it was the market, and my family was based here.
After school, this is where I would come.
This is where your dad had his stall.
We had a stall here for 50 years.
And the market is to be a place buzzing every day. Some special item, a flick knife, for instance, you'll get it in the market.
So this is also where Manning Rangers Football Club comes from.
Well, they started here.
Naidoo, Knuckles, the brothers.
They were part of the Styles Club, weren't they?
Part of the Styles gang.
Of course, and so was Daddy Naidoo and the awful Daddy Naidoo ran his awful stall here. And there was Cash Morgan, of course. Also had a stall here, didn't he?
The market was the hub, the nerve center of football.
Aces Football came out of the market. Crimson League came out of the market. Manning Rangers came from the market.
You had the likes of the Daddy Naidoos, the Mac Naidoos, the Vic Pillays.
Mac and his family also had quite a big stall in the market. G.R. Naidoo, Mac's elder brother, used to do training of all of us in that Villa Road area every afternoon when they come from the market. And it wasn't a joke. Eh? With G.R., we used to be hard at training. And that is how Mac became a very good fighter.
I secretly admired him because he would take on people in a fair fight and wallop them 10 out of 10 times.
The gangsters from Warwick Avenue were giving Aces a hard time. And Mac took those guys to the cleaners. They used to go under the name of Style Gang. And Salots and Style Gang had it out as well. Marketplace was one thing. You got to be a fit fellow. If you're unfit, then you cannot put up a fight. Rice and dry beans used to come in 200-pound bags. And we were able to lift those bags. It was part of our work, but unwittingly we were doing this. And that is why I'm still around. I used to train at Sonny Moodley's in Victoria Street. People like Daddy Naidoo, weightlifting, running. If you was not a fit person, then you cannot put up a good fight.
Look at that kilo. That's the only size I got. No bigger than that. 201, the big one here. The big one here, nice and lovely.
You
see the name?
Yeah, Seaman Chetty.
Now, Seaman had gone overseas pre-war. First South African fighter to have achieved a world ranking in the Bible of Boxing, the Ring magazine. He was rated sixth in the world amongst the flyweights. But his career was cut short when he volunteered to join the South African army, although it was segregated, in response to a call by the ANC for black people to support the war against Nazism. To cut a long story short, Seaman came back, started the fish stall, and was a very successful businessman, and he had a boxing school.
So many people that come and buy from us actually tell us different things about him and tell us, you know what, back in the day he was he owned a stream of buses and he did so much for the poor and he did this and did that. When he started off, he owned a fish and chip shop, he went into the fish business.
You know, never took up boxing?
No, my brother did that. I'm not into it.
But Dash, you got the build for a boxer.
Yes.
You know, they say there's no better fighter than a hungry fighter.
We had Marnie Williams from the Cape. We had Wally Thompson, Alex McKellar, Baby Batter, Michael Twaller, PM Pillay, Kid Sadamani, Louis Joshua. Oh, there's a whole string of them.
You know, the youngsters in the district had wonderful role models. Sonny Mudley ran a gym in Victoria Street. Under the stewardship of people like this, there was, you know, boxing activity blossomed.
If you talk to anybody about Louis Joshua, hey, I knew Louis. He is my knockout king. He worked as a paper boy, selling papers on the streets of Durban. And I think it was there that he was enlightened with the likes of Joe Louis Barron, reading articles in the paper about him. And then I think he had decided that he wanted to be famous, and he saw sports, especially boxing, as a way to reach that goal.
Joshua eventually challenged for the Natal bantamweight title, then held by John Tooley, great fighter John Tooley. It was a toe-to-toe slugfest, both guys going at each other, you know, hammering tongs, right from the first bell. At the end of the fight, Tooley slumped in his corner, Joshua won the title. They rushed Tooley to hospital. He was concussed.
That fight, he doesn't know what came over him. And Tooley was sent to the hospital for 3 weeks. When he regained consciousness, he said he never knew an Indian could hit so hard.
Now this is historical. This mosque, it's the largest mosque in the Southern Hemisphere.
Our next stop, Curries Fountain, just a few blocks from Grey Street. Curries, in the 1950s and 60s, and even well into the 80s, was at the heart of a thriving Indian soccer scene.
So, Mr. Singh, I mean, what was this place like in the 1950s?
During the 50s, I came out here to watch some of the star Indian players. And we had teams like Stella, Aces, Warwickshire, and all of them had the best players. When you came to this ground here, you could hear the screaming.
The vibe, the crowds, the old atmosphere, Curry's Fountain was unbelievable. It's probably some of the most exciting times of my life was spent at Curry's Fountain.
At that time, as you know, when it's a cup final, you can go into any house in Durban, Prince Edward Street, Grey Street, Indian home, because no one is at home.
I don't think there were many games at Curry's where we didn't attract a full house. Invariably, the ground would be jam-packed. It was fantastic. We had great players, the caliber of which I don't see today. You know, the likes of the Bob Pillay, the Dharam Mohan, V.C. Mudley.
Dharam Mohan, for instance, he built like an oak tree, Dharam Mohan. A dashing winger, later on to become a centre-forward in the professional side when he was well past his prime.
He played for Northern Natal with stars like Bob Pillay, Teddy Jamaluddin, Bal Satkur, Thiri Rampath. These were the star forwards of that period. Natalians were hoping to sign Dharam, but Avalon cut in between and brought him away to Durban. His heading of the ball was from another planet. He had thunder on both his feet.
You only had to ask Dan Naidoo. Dharam kicks. He says, don't try to stop the ball. You save a ducky.
In this ground, we were playing Blackpool. And Dharam kicked from that end against the goalkeeper, and the poor guy let the ball go in.
In our own little environment, this non-racial football, etc., etc., we were playing extremely good football.
And then there was a professional white soccer.
For the rest of the game, City concentrated wholly on keeping their lead. This they did, and when the final whistle went, the score was Durban City 2, Durban United 0.
We used to go there, pay 2 shillings, you can see the white soccer. It was very good. What can we do? See it in the morning and come back Curries Fountain in the afternoon.
Then one might ask, how do we compare ourselves to the whites? You know? Now that's not an easy comparison to make, because they were now getting people from England, English footballers.
Bolton Wanderers in South Africa take the field at Kingsmead, Durban, and there's promise of a close contest. Bolton went on the attack. Suddenly Perry moved across, and his power drive gave Rockersmith no chance whatever. Bolton Wanderers won, South Africa nil.
Baker Naidoo was an amazingly talented footballer, and you know he had hit the ceiling because he couldn't represent his country and all that. And he got a job on a ship. He jumped ship in Southampton, went to London, and asked Bolton Wanderers for a trial. They gave him a trial and they signed him on. And he was the first South African to play English First Division football.
There was no further score, and Bolton Wanderers won by the odd solitary goal.
Dan Naidoo was my younger brother. He was a household name, referred to as the cat.
Nat Loftus from Bolton Wanderers saw him play at Curries Fountain, and he said, this kid can play in any league in the world, you know.
But, you know, we Indians at that time were reluctant to leave home and go into grounds that we are not familiar with, so he didn't go.
I took over Aces Football Club in 1955, and we played racial football.
The social engineering, well, you had it in every aspect of your life. You had the Indian Football Association, the Colored Football Association, the African Football Association, and of course, FASA, they didn't call themselves a white football association. It was normal. It was a football association of South Africa.
The South African Indians in their own fold, the South African coloureds, the South African blacks, played in compartments.
I saw the South African Indians against the South African blacks. I think that was a match we had to all run away when there was disruption.
Bob Pillay from Maritzburg scored 2 quick goals. And unfortunately, that match ended up in a riot.
It taught us a lesson in that football must be played on a non-racial mixed basis.
And so they decided now that we have to get rid of these inter-race matches.
At the time, Aces United, which was affiliated to the Devon Football Association, had cleaned up all kind of opposition within Durban and also the province. I think about 6 of its players were selected for the South African Indian side at the time. And this growing consciousness now had come to a head.
And we met at the Goodwill Lounge, and we decided that we will no more be associated with anything that has any racial connotation attached to it.
Ramori Lachman was the president of the club. He said, now, let's get out of the amateur situation because we're not Indian.
We refused to play in the Semchana because Semchana meant it was an Indian tournament. When they found that the cream of the footballers refused to participate, then the unity talks began.
R.K. Naidoo was then the president of the Durban Indian Football Association. R.K. Naidoo took the decision, together with his committee, to remove the tag Indian and then accept all races.
We became Durban Football Association.
That, for me, is where the real integration in sport, the first kind of bullet was fired.
And in the meantime, you see, we were getting prompted by Dan Twala and company. And on the drawing boards was the fact that one top team, a black team from the Transvaal, is prepared to play us.
We went on a dream trip to Johannesburg to meet with Dan Twala with the whole idea of arranging a friendly with Morocco Swallows and Aces, and at the same time to talk about how we can form the first non-racial professional league.
And so they had a friendly here between Morocco Swallows and Aces. They had a crowd of 20,000.
What a match at so full house. And of course, contrary to expectation, we got a drubbing from them.
And subsequently, we formed the South African Soccer League with the Transvaal United, Morocco Swallows, Orlando Pirates, Real Fighters, and Blackpool from the Transvaal. Peter Maritzburg had Maritzburg City and Lincoln City.
Three teams were formed in Durban. Warwickshire became Birria. Aces became Aces United. Avalon Rangers became Avalon Athletic. All three teams chose the best people from the Black Association and the Coloured Association.
Our fight was not only about football, it was also about democracy, non-racialism. And we had it hard at times. One needs to understand it was virtually impossible to attract sponsors at those times.
And we had the Cape Ramblers taking part only in the Knockout Cup because of traveling cost.
But happy to say that the Federation was the body that really planted the first seeds for non-racial sport in this country.
Something that has been obscured in our history. I read present-day soccer history and no mention is made of that, because out of that initiative came Morocco Swallows and Orlando Pirates were given that break also. That is not mentioned, that is completely forgotten.
There was a gang related to almost every side, soccer side.
You know, you hear from the grapevine that the top market, the fish market, was Aces.
Yeah.
And the kingpin in Aces was Big Daddy. And Big Daddy was a very respected person here in the ground. Immaculately dressed.
He was the leader of the Crimson League. And he was also the coach. And I was then the manager of Aces Football Club.
So the Crimson League guys would support the Aces United team.
Warwickshire is from Warwick Avenue, and they called themselves the Dasheen Gang. With Manning Rangers, we had the Style Gang. We had some notorious guys there, we know that. And then in the Overport area, we had the Salot Gang. But when it came to Curries, nobody ruled here. V.C. Mudley, he had one eye.
Regularly featured for the South African Indians in the biennial Morocco-Boloi Interrace series.
Very hard to get past him. And he was outstanding.
You look at that stadium. On a big match day, the bets would be flying.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
And big money bets.
And there was no two ways about it. We were like outright favorites. And we were playing against Maritzburg City. It was their day. It just wasn't ours. And I remember, for some reason or the other, that was the last match that VC played, VC Modley, before he disappeared. And there I am in front of him. And we were losing 4-2. And believe you me, wasn't there praying for the whistle to blow.
One of the gangsters told him to leave a goal, not to save the ball. But he was not corruptible, and he had to pay the price.
To date, I don't think anyone is aware of what really happened to VC Motley.
the biggest kingpin in those days was Sharif Khan.
The mafia don.
He was a mafia don. He was the most sophisticated of all.
Dad is the only person who would break into a warehouse, empty the warehouse, move the goods, and have a police escort helping him move his goods. He said, there is no man who hasn't got a price.
Sharif Khan's gang were regarded to be defenders of the community.
If someone didn't pay them money, they'd come to my father. If their daughters ran away with somebody that they shouldn't be with, they'd come to my father. My father will say, fine, now your problem is my problem. Now you go home and sleep. I will take care of the rest. When I was a little girl, he had a plank, a thick plank that he had put into the ground, and he had thick rope tied around it. And every morning when he used to do his chumming and that, he used to go out in the yard and he used to box at this plank with the rope on it.
His handshake was like a steel grip.
He had knives, but I basically saw him do more damage with his fists than I think he could do with any knife. People said he used to intimidate people, extort people, do all that type of stuff. But he never ever spoke about the good things he did. Throughout our life, I've never known a Friday or an Eid day where the table was not set more than three times to feed people.
So Sastri was the only high school for Indian boys, is that right?
That's right, yeah. It was an all-boys school. And I remember 1951, the scene here. Hundreds of anxious parents will assemble here with their children. Principal will stand out here and with his secretary, and he'll read out from a list of the top 120 in the province who performed well in their Standard 6 exam so that they can get admission.
The sad thing about those that didn't make it, Thamba, was they ended up on the street. Because there was nowhere to go. There was no other school.
Yes.
You can't make it, now go look for a job or go to Victoria Street and hustle.
People like Michael John.
I only remember him for other things, but not for being a...
No, Michael's story here, in that particular year, they produced a play, and he should give the students tickets to sell. They gave Michael a book of tickets to go and sell. He was a student, brilliant student, and a hell of a nice guy. Very decent chap. He went and sold the tickets, but he used the money that month to pay the rent for his family at home.
That's so right.
He came back and said to him, sir, I used the money for that. Give me 2 weeks, I'll give you the money for tickets. He said, you use the money, that's stealing. They threw him out, and the rebel was born.
I knew Michael John because we were at Sastri College together. You know, he was some standards above me, very bright. And suddenly we heard that, you know, he had taken a different kind of path in life. And he joined the Crimson League. And then I think he got a little too big for his boots, as the top guys felt.
Michael John and his uncle formed the Michael John Gangsters. And he had, Michael John had a very big following. When he was going out on a mission, there were about 30 of them marching down that Queen Street area.
One day when I saw him standing there by Captain's balcony, you know that time there, standing with his coat, well, the guys are just giving him money, there's that.
He was extorting monies from the poor waiters in the beachfront. And we used to watch this. I met Michael John in Grey Street when I went to the Western Hotel to pick my brother up that evening. I saw Michael John with two others walking down from Smith Street along Grey Street. And I just pulled in with the car, and when I got off, I saw him, and I said, "Hello, Mike." And he came to me and shook my hands, and we were standing and talking. Then he said, "See, this dropped me in Lawn Street."
Michael, as far as, and I knew him personally, was a very nice person. He was the sort of guy, if a beggar stopped him, he'll give him something. But of course, he was in the gang world. The thing is, Michael wasn't just a thug. He also had a lot of brains. He was brilliant. That was the danger that these guys were facing. This is the old Eastern Dry Cleaners building. Been here forever. And this used to be the cottage where Michael John lived. He came out of Sastri College and he got into the underworld. And the fear was that someday he will take over and eliminate the Crimson League. So before he could do that, they decided to get rid of him.
They said it was time to put him away now.
It's largely as a result of self-help of the Indian community that they managed to educate their children.
There was always an emphasis on, I'm a parent, but my child's life must be better than mine. It also meant, as a community, investing in education.
The state did not provide schools for us, although our parents paid their rates and taxes. The community went about building its own schools. I recall my father working very hard. He'd get up at 5 in the morning, was a baker's van man, earning £5 a week. After work, he'd come back tired, but walk around with his friends in a committee and collect their pennies and put it together and build these schools.
In the 50s and before then, the University of Natal never admitted students of color. A lady called Dr. Mabel Palmer decided to start what was called the non-European section of the University of Natal. This venue was used for classes. There were some prefab put at the back. People like Mac Maraj and myself and so on got our BA degrees from the back of this place here.
That back area was called the hut.
Yeah, the hut. That's how that happened.
There's one photo of you on the steps of City Hall.
Yeah. The picture of the boycott you see outside the Durban City Hall is of students boycotting the graduation ceremony. We graduated writing the same degrees as whites, but at the graduation ceremony, they segregated us. Although I've got 2 degrees from University of Natal, I never attended a graduation ceremony.
Was it a political place? I mean, did people get conscientized here?
There was no more active student body, even in terms of today's standards, than the one that was operating from the back. When the ANC was banned, a lot of the ANC work was being done at the back of this building here. Monty Naicker himself, you don't get politicians of that sincerity today. One of the most committed and sincere politicians that be your pleasure ever to meet.
You know, he was one of the first Indian medical practitioners in South Africa, and he could have just not do anything and made a lot of money, and I could be retired by now. But he gave all that up and sacrificed that just for the people. Most of his patients were from the lower income group, from magazine barracks and from the townships, both African and Indian. That made him go into politics. And the majority were indentured laborers, the municipal workers and all. They were the ignored people, and the leadership of the NIC that time were more concerned about themselves.
There were elements in the Indian community who probably felt that the Indians could negotiate a better deal for themselves as a separate group from the other black communities. Both Monty Naicker and Yusuf Dadoo were responsible for the transformation of the Natal Indian Congress and Transvaal Indian Congress. Dadoo, I think, in the main, inspired by his Marxist politics, but in the case of Monty Naicker, I think inspired by his Gandhian politics.
Yusuf Dadoo was Communist Party, and nobody was more anti-communist than Monty Naicker. But you know, they were able to work together, which was fantastic.
My father always believed that the fight for freedom should be for everybody, not for Indians only. When my father took over the NIC, and I think about the same time Dadoo became the president of the TIC, their policy was non-compromising. They wanted freedom for everybody, and they exacted the same sort of freedom as the whites in this country.
The fate of the people of Indian descent in South Africa is tied up with that of the rest of the black people, and therefore it was necessary to build unity between Indian movements and African movements.
They got together with Ebi Kuma from the African National Congress, and they signed what was called a Doctor's Pact, bringing together two strong forces against the apartheid monolith.
What is significant about the transformation in the approach is that it made possible a campaign like the Defiance Campaign of 52 and then all the other subsequent mass actions during the 1950s. And that is what transformed both the NIC and the TIC and the ANC, because by acting together, both sides of the equation began to recognize the significance not only of unity, but most importantly, of united action. And you had whites participating, you had Indians participating, you had Africans participating, you had colored participation. That in itself had significance. Okay, we are all in this together.
But it wasn't just men in this struggle. Indian women played a vital role too. Back in the 40s, Dr. Goonam was a leader in the passive resistance campaigns. Thousands of Indians protested state plans to move them off their land. This recollection comes from her memoirs.
Our aim was to publicize our opposition to the Racist Act and to communicate to the whites how we felt about being discriminated against. Batches of volunteers, about 15 to 20, squatted on the side and were in time arrested by the police. That was passive resistance, the deliberate breaking of a law and defiantly bearing the consequences.
This is the site of the passive resistors in 1946.
Yeah.
And I think also 1952, the Defiance Campaign.
Yes.
It's very emotional to think that, you know, this was the site where the struggle took place, you know, so many years ago.
And Aziz, you dedicated your book to Dr. Goonam?
Yeah, I did.
I mean, inspired that?
I think any writer would have written and dedicated his book to Dr. Goonam. Because she was that feisty, fighting, belligerent woman that took no nonsense from anybody. She led the women into resistance.
A maverick in more ways than one, but a totally dedicated political figure. She was arrested 18 times, and they couldn't shut her up.
She's done so much in the Indian community. The bag ladies from magazine barracks, she was their mentor, she helped them. And when the corporation was wanting to get rid of the bag ladies, saying that they were
unhygienic. Goonam was there. She came to the rescue of a lot of people.
She was an educationist. She was a trailblazer. She went where no other woman, particularly Indian woman, had been before her. She was a spokesman for women's lib, if you'd like to call it that, at a time when we didn't know about women's lib, really.
She lived her own life. And, my play centers on this kind of different path that she took. Because, of course, Indian women were very, heavily discriminated against. Indian men were terribly chauvinist. I mean, Indian women had to be in the kitchen and that sort of thing.
Luckily, she had a father with some coins. She was able to go and study medicine. I mean, she was the first woman, eh?
And one of the things that she said to other women who are bound there was, "There but for fortune. I had an opportunity to go. You didn't have that opportunity, but don't de-emphasize your importance," sort of thing.
My father said to me, "I don't want to see you with that woman. She smokes."
Dynamic women like Goonam, who broke stereotypes, who would be smoking a cigarette with a cigarette holder and drinking her whiskey without being inhibited by tradition. And yet she spoke Tamil very well.
And she'll drive the flashiest cars, And of course, all the men were so uptight about female smoker and driving these, sporty cars.
She wore a botu, but she drank and she smoked, and she wore short dresses. She would, of course, wear a sari too on occasion, and she lived her life as exactly she wanted. She went to India, sought a job while she was away in India. She was a specialist in birth control. Eventually, she was referred to the Prime Minister himself, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. They were having a chat, and he said, "But where's your husband?" And she said, "Why?" He said, "Well, you said you had four children, didn't you, or three children?" And she said, "Do I have to have a husband to have three children?"
The 50s was a very bad time for Indian women because parents felt that they should get married and be off. Girls were allowed to go to school to standard six, and if they didn't get married, then by the 18, when they were regarded to be on the shelf.
In some quarters, she may have been seen as an instigator, a troublemaker who was, unsettling the waters. Women were quite content with going to school until standard four, standard six, perhaps, and then taking on the role of wife and mother. And she came and she rocked the boat.
Was there a personal cost to all of this, your mum being so active?
She was a people's doctor. And very often she was paid with groceries and potatoes and things like that. Psychologically, certainly, because of all the imprisonments and eventually the exile, we did pay a huge cost in terms of family. She was there, but she wasn't there because she belonged to the people.
The snail parade course consists of long straights with extremely sharp bends at the extremities.
You see, you had the circular wooden wall and it was centrifugal force. To get started and to get into that force, it took a lot of guts. And Tommy Chetty had perfected it together with this remarkable woman, Amaranee Naidoo.
So there was a friend, Mr. Tommy Chetty. He should come and speak to me, and he should ask me, why do I look at the bike? And then I said, no, it's very nice. So he says, no, he's got a merry-ground, and he has a wall of that. He is a wall of that rider. He asked me if I will be interested in pillion riding. I said, I try. Well, my mom wasn't too happy, but my dad was in my favor. He said, if I want to, but it's going to be very risky, and why am I choosing that? I said, I like to do and I want to be somebody different. And after the show, I'll have many come in talking to me and proud of me. So that was making me more proud myself. For a while, I rode Pillion. Then when I started learning to ride a bike and I started riding on my own. When I get into the wall, I light my lamp first of all, the Aladdin lamp. In case of the power goes off, then I have lights to come down. And I should rev the bike and all, and I prepare my bike. And then on the ramp, once you take off, and then you go onto the wall. So the speed takes you onto the wall. It was about 60 to 80 RPM. If I slow down my speed, I know I'm coming down. And I remember once the chain came off my bike. It was Royal Enfield. So I slipped and I came down, no balance.
I think that that's quite amazing by anyone's standards, because even Western women hadn't gone into that area with such bravado.
Ladies, they just want to be housewives at that time. I was different using pans and all that, but that never worried me.
Because of the image of the subservient Indian woman, the Indian girl, this was a total breakaway. Together with Tommy Chetty, they would hold audiences in thrall. Wherever you went, the audiences were packed. You know, you had huge crowds and looking down into this wall of death thing.
Heave-ho, ladies, as an innocent piece of rope takes an awful beating during the Easter Monday Indian sports on Durban Beach.
Easter? It was like Christmas in July for us. We all used to go. You can say the whole of Durban used to be there. Children, people, everyone. That time, everyone with their saris used to come.
And some novelty sports add to the holiday mood. For the girls, there was a hair plaiting race, and this was no time to become fumble-fisted. It was sort of a distance race, too, as it took quite a while to run out of hair. Everyone had a wonderful time.
Kemps, he was the one that started this life-saving movement with B.B. Singh. Mr. B.B. Singh, Sundays, you should go to the Durban Beach, bringing all these boys there. And then they were doing voluntary, this thing, what you call life-saving. And he got hold of my brother and all his friends. He did a lot of things. He brought all the scholarly boys in town, little gangsters. I mean, we were that's how they used to call us, gangsters, this, then all this. He made them all swimmers, great swimmers. They learned swimming. After five, because when the police used to come, they used to catch them, you see. After five, no police. So after work, they all used to go and train there. And that's how they became swimmers.
I knew B.B. Singh when I first started off life-saving. I was still in Nipper. It was still called Durban Indian Life-Saving Club. And he used to come visit us every Sunday morning and visit the guys, do his little prayer on the beach, spend time with the guys till lunchtime, and he used to go home.
Cookie, your dad, looking at photographs of him, is a pretty fit guy and very tough looking. Would you call him a macho man?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Absolutely. My father was my role model. I would put my sister and my mother also, but the person that really stood out was my father. More so because he ruled all of us like how he was in the army. When it came to swimming, he expected the best out of all of us.
And what they had, no modern things. They had one big reel, you know, the reel, that one, if anyone drowns, they put that thing on and they go inside. There was no, changing room, anything there for them.
I was the first Indian girl in the apartheid era. The first black woman to have a swimming instructor's and a life-saving award.
The other beaches, eh? The African and colored beaches.
See, they divided it off. Initially, in front of the snake park, was everybody's beach but the whites. The whites were more the other side. Then they moved the Indians, and when they moved, they said, no, the Indians must move. And then the little section from, it was like, you know, this 200 meters is Indian beach. The next 200 meters is the colored beach. And the next 200 meters is the African beach. But nobody bothered about it. And I said nobody, apart from the people of the whites who swam in their area. The Indians, colored and blacks all swam wherever they were. They never gave up.
So there wasn't that much division between
those? There wasn't that division, really. Nobody cared. And to a large extent, I think you must give BBC credit for that.
Tell me a little bit about Papa's group.
He played golf with a rather unorthodox group, which became known, popularly known, as the Papua group. The right group is this, okay? Now, Papua club gripped the club with his right hand on top, left hand at the bottom, actually meant for the left-hand golfer.
Papua Segolam, the man with the wrong way grip, is handily placed when he puts his drive down the fairway.
Papua came on the scene as a youngster, where he won what was called in those days a Natal non-European golf championship. He virtually won the first 14 or 15 championships and was clearly way ahead of other golfers.
Papua, as usual, playing an immaculate short game, trips from just off the green to within handy distance and sinks the putt.
He was the poorest of the poor, and he eked out a living caddying.
He commenced as a caddy at the Beechwood Golf Club in the Durban North area and was caddying for Graham Wolfe, who later invented Oil of Olay.
Graham Wolfe saw talent in him, took him in his private aeroplane across Africa into Europe, where he won the Dutch Open in 59.
This triumph was a great breakthrough for people of color playing sport in South Africa, because it illustrated what was obvious to everybody, that all people are as good as each other at sport. Although he was illiterate, he won this tournament and was acclaimed on the European stage.
Gary Player goes for a long one and is just a shade too firm. The ball finishes a yard or so past the flag.
In 1965, Papa beat Gary Player by one shot on this very green to win the Natal Open. I think the black community went absolutely head over heels for a man who they believed was going to change the country in one way or the other.
The game, in a sense, became a titanic struggle between someone who was established as a white racist and the champion of the non-whites, as they were called in those days. Every time he needed to play, he needed to apply to the minister under the Group Areas Act for permission to play in a white tournament, because that was allegedly a white group area.
It was taboo for black people to get into the clubhouse under any circumstances during the apartheid time.
And is that why Papa then also collected his check in 63?
Outside in the rain. His manager's car parked right outside the caddy master's quarters, where he changed, had his lunch, came out to tee off for the second 18 in other clothing. But all of that was done outside, simply because he was not allowed in the clubhouse.
After a while, Papua became sort of stereotyped or typecast as the Indian miner, the nuisance in South African sport, because he played it so well. Once he'd beaten Gary Player, he'd beaten the great white champion, and they then stopped him playing and they refused permission every time he applied. Here he was proving that apartheid was posited on totally wrong premises. It's posited on the basis of inferiority of people.
The plaque is where the presentation more or less took place, in a pigeonhole area. Yeah, this plaque is positioned presently in the new building of the Durban Country Club, facing the 18th hole. But this is more or less where Papua received his trophy in pouring rain. And to honor him, many, many years later, I think it was in the 90s, that a plaque was positioned on the wall.
It's almost in time to come, by not putting the date on, people will actually think that the establishment of this club actually acknowledged Papua all along.
But, you know, there used to be that saying, you know, that evil never lasts. And apartheid was evil. And like all things in nature, it passed. They don't have dancing like they used to. Those days we had, like I said, it started Himalaya, then you had the Admiral, then from there you had Pelican opened up, and there was Railway Hotel. All these places all had bands. They had resident bands.
One of the top bands in those days was Sam's Latin Kings. That was Sam Abrams.
What a following, I tell you. You know, basically coloureds and Indians, we used to mix in there, and we used to have a rollicking time.
It was mixed, but you see, now that was illegal.
Sam's Latin Kings played purely dance music, and on certain occasions we played Latin American music, jazz at times. Occasionally played with us was Lionel Martin Pillay. Excellent music. He is compared to any overseas artist.
Lionel Pillay was another genius, I would say. Another genius on the keyboards, on the piano at least.
And Lionel, he played with the giants, I should say, from overseas and everywhere. The greatest pianist I've ever played with.
He was gifted with perfect pitch. When a band tunes up, you'll be able to tell it just like that. That guy's perfect pitch, the other's not.
And then we had Gambi George, one of the finest drummers in the country, played with some of the top artists. He went overseas and he did amazingly well in jazz internationally.
The manager at the time of Sam's Latin Kings was David Jack.
Yes.
And he was quite a character, wasn't he?
Yes. David Jack was a very short-tempered person, from my knowledge. But a gentleman to a point.
And he also played for the Crimson League at times, you see. But mind you, they took very good care of the band.
Being a band manager those days, you had to see that nobody interferes with the musicians.
Sure.
And he was a master at that. If anybody misbehaved...
Pumpy Naidoo was an amazing entrepreneur.
He was a personal friend of mine. He loved my band. There were times we used to rehearse in Pumpy Naidoo's restaurant in the back.
He used to promote shows. He used to promote boxing and I think wrestling those days. And he was involved in a lot of sports and he was a socialite himself.
A man that united the community. You know, he was way ahead of his time. His restaurant was the meeting place for people of all races. Whether they were white or brown, black, pink, yellow, anybody, it was the cultural melting pot of Durban.
Goodwill Lounge was very exclusive. Like us, we never had the money to go there.
Pumpy was a jazz aficionado, and he would invite the top jazz players of the time, including Dollar Brand, who is now Abdullah Ibrahim, Lionel Pillay, Sonny Pillay, Gambi George, to his sessions, jazz sessions at the Goodwill Lounge, which, you know, us youngsters used to look forward to, and we'd get there. It was an amazing kind of atmosphere.
Pumpy was very good to me. Several times when people were locked up, I'd go to him and he'd just look at me and says, "Hamni, food." He'll pack in cartons, you know, for me to take mince and rice or something.
Himself and his brother Nami ran an honest operation. They were there to do business and to serve the community. And it is there at the Goodwill Lounge where they were allow gangsters to come and be paying customers, but they could not flex their muscles. And I think
they were gangsters, but they never interfered with ladies and all this thing. They fought amongst themselves and all, you know, territory. You know, this taking my territory, this, that, and everything.
No, I didn't see the fights. I just saw very nice human beings, caring, will help old ladies cross the road, you know?
I had so many things about the Crimson League being bad guys and, you know, terrible guys and all. I don't know that part. There's one thing I know about these gentlemen. They are, I would say, gentlemen. They are there to help you when there's a need.
Also, you know, where I got food for these chaps who were detained was the Crimson League, Daddy Naidoo.
I dropped Michael John in the corner of Grace Street and Lawn Street. And I was shocked the next day when I heard that he was murdered.
It was a messy job. I think it was his daughter's birthday. And a group of these guys got into his house and they butchered him, literally butchered him in the presence of his family.
His children were here. And these chaps went in with choppers and pangas and chopped him. I mean, that's gruesome. You know, can you imagine what his family went through?
It almost wanted to set an example of...
It was undone. This was never done before. It was almost like a philosophy. The gangsters had their gang war. They never interfered with families. So if you were the leading gangster and they were gunning you, they would not touch your family. This was unusual. When you ask that question, who killed Michael John? Everybody knows that it was the Crimson League.
Now it's a question of going down to which hitmen.
The police then cited me as one of the suspects because I dropped him last. And the police took me in to and took a statement from me, and I appeared in court for the case, and I gave evidence. I was suspect number one. They felt that I knew what was going on, and I left him there. I said, no, that's not the story. The story was quite a different story, that I had no idea that that was going to take place that night.
And now there were those seven that were picked up. Five of them had nothing to do with it.
That's
they
true.
Were never even on the scene. They were just fall guys to cover up.
What was interesting is the seven accused were also friends of mine, and some of them were my schoolmates. No evidence to prove beyond doubt that so-and-so was responsible for that murder. And we were able to get that case over, and the seven accused were freed.
Immediately after India achieved its independence in 47, Dr. Dadoo and Dr. Naicker visited India. They said, okay, look, we want you to broadcast about situation in South Africa. And as they arrived there, Dr. Dadoo tells me, he said to GM Naicker, you know, I don't trust my Gujarati enough to speak in Gujarati here in India. I'm going to speak in English. And GM said to him, no, I'm in India, I'm going to speak Tamil. They got on the radio, Dr. Dadoo broadcast in English, and Dr. Naicker spoke in what he assumed was Tamil. When they came out of the studio, the technicians and INC officials were congratulating, said, oh, very good, Dr. Dadoo. Very good, very impressive. And then they went to Dr. Naicker and said, oh, very good. We don't know what language it was, but very good nonetheless. And Dadoo said it amused him because it indicated that the Tamil that was spoken in South Africa had transformed that much since 1860, that it was no longer understood in India. They didn't even know it was Tamil anymore. And he said there was one saving grace for him, Yusuf Muhammad Dadoo, about that, because it meant that the South African Indian community were no longer Indians. They actually had become South Africans.